As a film producer, you spend a lot of your life looking for stories. So it dawned on me, perhaps slightly slowly, that I was sitting on a story that I knew an awful lot about. But I was very trepidatious about trying to bring it to the screen, because there would be nothing worse than making a family biopic that you didn't like yourself. So I went about it very slowly, and the first ingredient was the writer. I saw a play called Shadowlands some years ago, written by Bill Nicholson, which I adored and cried all the way through. And it had the right tone, I felt, for the story that I wanted to tell. I then worked with Bill on a film, Elizabeth Golden Age, and afterwards I asked him if he would write this story, and he said that he would, but on one condition. And that condition, which is a lovely thing for a producer to hear, is he said, "Don't pay me until and unless the film happens." So I thought, okay, that's very good. His logic being, this is your story, so it mustn't fall into the hands of anybody else. It mustn't be controlled by anybody else. So we worked on the script for many years, in between Bill's other jobs and assignations. And then the critical ingredient was bringing on Andy Serkis as the director, who introduced all sorts of other elements to the script beyond what Bill and I had developed. But the critical thing, which came together last year, was finding the two people who Andy and I felt would best and most beautifully portray my parents, and here they are. And the moment that we met them both, we knew that we had to make the film.
Jonathan and I had set up this company, The Imaginarium, which was really all about next generation storytelling using performance capture. It was a performance capture studio with a production entity joined together. And so we were looking at material, you know, building a slate across film, TV, video games, virtual reality, augmented reality, and stage, for all sorts of expression of great stories. You know, how we would tell stories in the next 10, 20 years' time, and the technology that would allow us to do that. And we both brought ideas to our increasing slate. And of course, one of the projects that had been living with Jonathan for a few years beforehand was the project that he'd been working on with Bill. One night I read the script, and it was as we'd started to work on lots of our other projects that we were developing, and I read it, and it was the most powerful, moving, extraordinary story, and brilliantly rendered by Bill, and brought me to, you know, emotionally to pieces, actually. And that has never, I don't think, happened to me before, or hadn't happened to me before, to that level by purely reading a script. So I went the next day and I said, "Jonathan, can we meet for lunch?" And all these things happen at lunchtime, don't they? So we sat down and had lunch, and I came into the restaurant and quite trepidatiously said, "I'd really like to direct your parents' story." And it didn't seem that, you know, it was sort of slightly outside of my wheelhouse traditionally. You know, we were working on lots of other extraordinary things, and this was an extraordinary story, but in a more conventional form. And Jonathan said yes, that he thought it was a good idea. And I explained what I loved about it, and apart from the fact that it was a most incredible script and an extraordinary love story and a true love story about true love, was that these people were mavericks. They were outsiders. They were pioneers. They were people who were breaking the mold and shattering the idea of what it is to be disabled back in those times, and through personal tenacity and great wit and great buoyancy and great humour, were able to move people and transform other people's lives. So that was how it came together.
Bill's script is so moving, and it's very rare you read a film script that just kills you and just makes you a blithering mess of a person in a puddle of your own tears and snot. And that's what happened to all of us. And then we tried to just do that justice and do the lives of Jonathan's parents justice. It felt like a template of how to live, how what Robin and Diana did. Somehow they made such a joyous, inspired, fully lived, rich life experience out of terrible loss, and we all go through loss. That's why I think it's such a universal story and such a inspiring story for every person, no matter where they come from or what their specific imprisonment or loss is. It feels universal in that way, and I think... So for me, I just read it, I was like, oh, I want to live like that. I want to live like how they lived, and maybe by doing it, some of Robin and Diana and Jonathan will rub off, and it didn't. But I tried. Just a technical challenge to make it second nature, I think. The inability to follow physical impulses, and also the rhythm of the breathing machine, that was probably the trickiest technical challenge, because as we know, like right now, my breathing as I'm speaking to you is rather nervous, and it's kind of jagged and out of rhythm, and I get to have thoughts interrupt and it affects my breath. But when that's happening for Robin and other people who live on ventilators, there's just this one stream of breath. So it's very, very hard to express panic or joy or any different kind of emotion. So all of that I found went into my face. And I think that's what happened with Jonathan's dad, is that his eyes became all that more alive. There was the soul, all of his longings, all of his emotion and feeling came, his eyes and his face were his main form of expression. That was the purest transmission of who he was. And then he had to master the breathing machine. He had to master how to use the breathing machine like an instrument. And he used to get very, very frustrated because people would finish his sentences. So he had to figure out a way of finishing, like going halfway through a thought and finishing on a word that no one would have any idea where he was going, in order to not be interrupted. So little things like that, which I just found so inspiring. And he was so creative and imaginative with how he remained in control of his own life. So it was things like that that I found very inspiring. There is something truly heroic about the life that Robin created with Diana and with their friends. And I think what's important to underline and highlight is that it was a community effort. It wasn't this one man and his superheroics, which is a story that we get fed a lot in our culture now. But in fact, I think there's some other story that I believe will save us from the terrible situation we're in culturally and societally, that we are all absolutely needed, that everyone has some genius to offer the world. And I think that one of the remarkable things about the script and about the story of Jonathan's life and his parents' life is that it took a village. It really did. If it wasn't for Teddy Hall's inventive brilliance and his love, if it wasn't for the devotion of Diana's brothers, if it wasn't for the devotion of Robin's friends, then life wouldn't have been so beautiful. So I find that incredibly heroic, that everyone was showing up and pouring themselves into the situation. What was the other part of the question? I saw as much footage as was on offer, and it was mostly footage from when Robin was older, when Jonathan started to interview him and ask him lots of questions, we're all kind of grateful that there is that footage, but stacks and stacks of old beautiful photo albums, and maybe more than anything, talking to people who knew him. That was, and really through Jonathan, I feel Robin's presence very much through Jonathan. He is definitely his father's son in all those beautiful ways.
I should sort of back this up by saying, because my father's a doctor and built a hospital in, I'm half Iraqi, and my father built a hospital in Baghdad, and my mother taught disabled children. So I actually witnessed technology at first hand quite early on at the school where she taught, where children with spina bifida and thalidomide and other paraplegics and polio sufferers were using possum machines and various different things. So I felt that I had, and also my sister is an MS sufferer. So really, my points of connection were more about for instance, I know how difficult it is for her to get around in 2017 in a wheelchair. I cannot understand how they physically possibly could maneuver around or be around, get around in the 1960s and 70s. So really it was, my inspirations for this film came, and you, like the family that you were talking about, this village of people, I was brought to mind of the story of Philippe Petit and Man on Wire story, and that great heist of being able to string a wire up between the Twin Towers, and this devoted bunch of followers, this cabal of sort of enablers that enabled him to do that. Really, really, that idea of living life 2 minutes away from death, and but sort of in a Heath Robinsonian, just sort of inventing life moment by moment, and an accumulative effect of that, you know, once your life, your own life becoming fulfilled, enabling to others to fulfill their own. Those are the things that really, really fired me up. I mean, Jonathan and I have been, you know, with the company, have been trying to push the boundaries in terms of storytelling, and it's not about the technology, you realise, it's about the people.
I never had any quick comic timing. I think everyone else is quite funny around us. You were hilarious, Andrew. but I don't know. I mean, when you've got people like Tom Hollander, who's playing twins, you just sit back and watch, really, in awe of it. But I think that was, as much as I can gather, is exactly how Robin and Diana lived their life. They were constantly having parties and friends round, and, you know, just tried to find the funny side of a really terrible situation. But I think that's human nature, really, and that's what you try and do. If you can't laugh, then you'd cry. And we do both in this film, I think, quite a lot, both.
I did see this from the start, really, as the story of a marriage rather than the story of a disability. And although the disability completely informs everything. But when you're writing about the tensions and stresses within a marriage, particularly English people, I think we deal with pain through humour very, very typically. So it was very important to get that in. So when Jonathan fed me and Diana, his mother, fed me all they could about what happened, I was picking up very strongly on anything that gave me an opportunity for a comic scene or comic dialogue. And of course, the twins are an absolute gift. And I mean, I do think, I must emphasize what Claire said. I think Tom Hollander's performance as two separate people is unbelievably subtle and clever and funny, considering he's not there when he's performing, if you see what I mean. Quite a remarkable piece of work.
It's a very rare situation, you know, when you make a film that you actually don't look back on it with any regret in any frame of it. I'm particularly grateful for these two, because it wasn't just that they got the spirit of my parents. They somehow encapsulated them. And Claire spent quite a lot of time with my mother. And they have similarities of character, perhaps, but for Andrew to recreate somebody who has been dead for 23 years was just to me, and to anybody who knew my father, literally extraordinary. About 3 weeks before we started shooting, I was checking my messages, and I got a message from my father. using all the words that he used to call me Jay, and I was completely overwhelmed and frankly confused, slow-wittedly. And at the end, the voice said, "How was that?" And of course, it was him. And it was an extraordinary thing. I have one regret, which is really a regret of my mother's. When we showed my mother a clip of the film for the first time, and my mother loves the film, thank God. We showed her a sort of 5-minute clip, and I said, "Don't say anything, just watch it through." It's a bit of, you know, quite a big thing for her. And halfway through, she'd been keeping it in as long as she can. She said, "Oh, I would never have worn that hat," which was the hat she wore in the hospital. So that is my regret, that we allowed her to wear the hat.
And how did she feel about the film, Jonathan?
Well, she absolutely loves the film. I mean, the first time she watched it, she was terrified, which I've never seen before, actually. It's the first time in my life, interestingly, that I've seen her frightened. She said, "I've decided to take the view that this film is not about me at all." So I went, "Okay, that's probably why." And she was sort of in shock, I think, because everything had come back in a most extraordinarily powerful way. She's seen it a couple of times since, and she does absolutely love it. It also is the first thing I've ever done that has validated my own professional life. My mother and I started a charity called CS Disabled Holidays some time ago, which provides grants for severely disabled people to allow them to go on holiday. Because obviously what we don't think about so much is that disabled people need holidays more than anybody else does, and they are probably less likely to be able to go on them for lack of resources and lack of care and everything else. And because my father's huge belief was in quality of life for people like himself, that's what he fought his life for. Once he had arranged a way for himself and my mother and me to have a good life, he then turned his attention to helping everybody else. And in a very small way, that's what we're trying to do with this charity. But we're also involved with the polio eradication regime, the polio fellowship, all sorts of other organizations who hopefully will profit from the general awareness of severe disability that this film throws up.
I don't think he had any idea who I was.
Still doesn't.
We're a very similar age, but he, but he started doing this a lot longer before than I did. So I, as a young-ish person who was training to be an actor, looked at him and went, oh my God, what are you doing? Yeah, I did. I just think he's amazing. And I always did. And never would have thought our paths would have crossed. I haven't been ruined by working with him. I now think differently of him, but yeah. I still think he's just amazing. And he's the most incredible, incredible actor.
I hadn't seen Claire's work before, and I didn't know her at all. And it was really an amazing vision that Andy and Jonathan had about us working together. That I was very happy to trust, and then I found out that it was beyond remarkable, and that she's beyond remarkable, as we all know now. It was genuinely one of the most profound kind of artistic, creative, and kind of friendships that I've ever fostered and been a part of. So there.
Robin and Diana are very much a product of their time and their upbringing and the morals and standards of that time. I don't think that relationships in the world that we live in are anything to do with the fact that anyone becomes ill or there's a crisis in some way and people just jump ship. I think that's just to do with the change in society and the way things are and life and views and options and all those sorts of things. But I think this circumstance and this scenario is very human, and I think that's beyond time and anything like that. I think people behave exactly the same now. People support people they love and look after them and care for them in just the same way now as they did then. Do you want anything to add?
I think we're all still longing for that kind of true love connection, whether it's for a lifetime or for as long as it's needed. I'm a little bit scared of the puritanical idea of one person for the rest of your life. If that works, that's wonderful, and if it doesn't, that's also wonderful. I think some people are meant to come together to create children, and then they have the third act of their lives alone, whatever that is. I think ascribing any one rule to marriage, one rule to partnership. I mean, the diversity of nature, I believe, is reflected in all of our uniqueness as human beings. I think there are so many ways of living a connected life of love and partnership, and I think it's each to their own, really.
You had, like, an actress that you thought that you could tip or you would like to see take on the role of the Queen after you leave the role?
I know who's doing it.
You do?
Yeah, and I'm not telling you. So there. It's really exciting and great and amazing.
Tell us.
I'll go on then. I always knew from the get-go that I was only going to be doing two series. So I'm just very, very grateful that I have had such a wonderful time playing that part and making friends for life and just had the best time ever. And so I'm very, very grateful and amazed that I can go and do other stuff, hopefully. This job came along at a time where I thought I was going to have a holiday and a rest and a break, and I didn't do that. I'm very grateful for this one too. I'm just very grateful all the time.